From Corolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, from The Offspring, Dexter Holland. With Gina Grad on news, Bald Brian on sound effects, and Vinny Tortorich drops by, and now, he's been dealing with lab leaks for years. Every time Phil pisses on the carpet, Adam Carolla.
Oh, that's a good one. Light patient load today. Yeah, get it on. Got to get on a choice to get on a mandate. Get it on. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grad?
That's right.
Hey, Bald Brian.
Hey, old friend.
Vinny Tortorich is going to come in. He's going to zoom in. He's going to talk to us all about all the impossible meats that are coming your way. What could go wrong?
Yes, thoughts.
What could go wrong? And then we'll talk to our friend Dexter from The Offspring.
Can we do his segment from his van? Because I would like to see inside of it since you've hyped it.
It's true.
It's a good question. Does Dexter drive the custom van? He did it last time he was here. All right. Let's see.
I've paid to see The Offspring. Like, you know, we've worked the classic, or a classic, modern rock station. We can get tickets to The Offspring whenever we want. I paid to see The Offspring.
Well,
it's a goddamn good show.
They rock so hard. I told you guys that when we were at the old, God, where did we do that acoustic Christmas?
Gibson Amphitheater?
No, the old, I keep wanting to say the Egyptian, but it wasn't the Egyptian. It was the one that's right by your campus on USC.
Downtown.
Oh, yeah. The Shrine.
The Shrine, the old Shrine, probably built in the 20s.
Oh, big room.
I got to tell you, as a man with some structural engineering in my background, when that place, the Shrine must have been built in, 1919 or something. Max Pata can look it up. But when the Offspring hit the stage and they were rocking so hard, the entire balcony, it has a huge balcony, everyone was jumping. And I was standing in the wings. And I was just looking at the balcony, and it was flexing down 3 feet in the middle and popping back up. And I'm like, this is an old building. This is not all the caissons and number 8 rebar and all the over reinforced engineering that's going on in today's world.
And balcony that thing held up with ghosts and and prayers.
1926, the Shrine Auditorium was built, and I thought they were going to break it in 1997.
Is that the first day you felt old?
It used to be the Al Malika Temple in 1906.
Of course.
All right. It was built a long time ago. Either way.
More davening, less partying.
Yeah.
A 15-year-old Adam Carolla would have been up there.
Yeah.
If you could ever get a
like
ticket.
That's right.
Pulling down on
right. But I was standing in the wings watching these guys rock. So that was cool. My favorite Offspring song may be Gone Away.
Gone Away is a great song.
I love that song. Anyway, and Dexter, I think, has a PhD in
molecular biology.
He
just got it, too. Like, he was like credit short for like 2 decades. I was like, fuck it.
Yes.
Remember when we had Dexter and Noodles on and how different their bios were? One was like, a pilot and a molecular biologist. And one was like, got in a fight with a skinhead.
Noodles was like, I made a bong out of a paper towel roll.
I love that guy.
That's what makes the band great.
Yeah.
Shrine underwent a $15 million renovation in 2002.
Oh, good.
But this was definitely before then.
After the Offspring show, they're like, we got to fix this up.
Too much deflection. Too much flex in that balcony. All right, we'll turn up a little.
Here it comes.
Yeah, that whole balcony is just bouncing right now. All right, so we'll bring Dexter in.
You dig this. Dexter, of course, proud USC alum. He went there and got his molecular biology
degree. At Keck, right?
What's that?
At Keck, I think.
Perhaps. I don't know that detail, but I do know that the U.S. First of all, I've been at games where he has maestroed the USC band.
Mm-hmm.
And the band plays many Offspring songs.
Mm-hmm.
You
did really?
A big horn. Oh, yeah. They play The Kids Aren't All Right. Play some deeper cuts, too, like Neocon.
There are times, and because, Adam, you love a good horn section, too, there are times mm-hmm. I go down the YouTube rabbit hole of university marching bands mm-hmm. and like their covers. And there's some amazing ones.
See if you can find a video over there, Chris.
That'd be great.
Doing an Offspring song. I mean, they've done it many times.
Or Tusk.
I'll buy you a little time. Also, tell you to, speaking of horns, it just good horns, it just reminded me of when Jimmy, you guys may not know this because I never really talked about it, I don't think, but.
Construction, boxing.
Jimmy and I, no, this has to do with arrows.
Oh.
Jimmy and I had a thought at some point early on with my Bertram career that we would do Bertram the stage show.
Okay.
And I had this notion that we should conduct it as if everyone is here from class. So the audience would be the class. Okay.
That's
and
cool.
This would be the first day mm-hmm. of Remedial Wood. And I would come out and I would address them as, you know, if you check your card, your registration card says Remedial Wood, and I put the fat people in the center and the thin people around the outside, so we didn't. So if the locker room went up again, we wouldn't have a bunch of fat asses stuck in the emergency exit, sending us all to a fiery grave. You know, it was like, I'll do the whole spiel, I'll get the chalkboard out, but I forgot and was included in the Geo folder that he sent with the Bertram. We actually recorded Jimmy as the principal. Because the thing was going to start. I remember when I was a kid in junior high, they'd go, all right, now class begins. And they play like Grand Old Flag mm-hmm. or something like through the intercom mm-hmm. system.
Yeah.
And if you're walking in the hall, you had to stop.
You
imagine
did,
those
really?
Quaint days. Well, they'd play like the Pledge of Allegiance or
right,
the Star Spangled
Banner.
And you'd have to stop.
Wow.
You couldn't be walking through the hall during the national anthem. But I forgot all about it. I forgot that we never did the stage show because I got on the love line 10 minutes later and got busy and we didn't need it anymore. But Jimmy thought, well, this will be a good showcase for you. And I was like getting together the props. We bought a slide projector. We took pictures of Brad Higginstaller, I think was Big Tad.
Mm-hmm.
We took pictures of him and we're going to do the whole slide presentation. And it just... I immediately just got on the love line and just scrapped the whole thing. But we had recorded Jimmy doing the principal over the intercom, and that was in the file. So
wow.
I'll play you that. It's just audio, obviously.
Unearthed. This is about literally unearthed.
Unearthed. Yeah. Yeah. And the horn reminded me because I think we told my dad to play the trumpet.
Oh, good.
Students, please rise.
Hold on, do we have the beginning?
This is
is that the very beginning?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that was the very beginning.
Is there a school bell or something?
Yeah, I don't know. Go ahead, sorry. My bad.
Students, please rise.
It's probably Cleto actually playing this.
Thank you, Ben Sussman, for that.
I could do it better.
Tomorrow, Ben. Good morning, students. This is Vice Principal Tomey, and on behalf of the faculty and staff, welcome to another exciting semester of learning at Louis Pasteur Business School. In compliance with state regulation and... Hey, Ben. The carpet. In compliance with state regulation and district policy, please begin your moment of non-denominational silence now. All right. Due to the rather large influx of new Americans, the following announcements will be broadcast in the following languages: English, Spanish, and Mandarin Chinese. And in the interest of fairness, tomorrow's announcements will be made in Japanese, Tagalog, and Sign. Please pay attention when you recognize your native tongue. The class you are in now is your homeroom class. The teacher in that class is your homeroom
teacher. Oh, I must have been the homeroom teacher.
All report cards will be issued through your homeroom teacher. Please look at your registration cards now. If you are not in the correct homeroom class, please notify your instructor now. Go.
Go.
Thank you. El clase tu eres en es su casa cuarto. El maestro en esa clase es tu maestro de casa cuarto. Todas las libretas de notas le será enviado tu maestro de tu casa cuarto. Por favor, ver su carteras de registración. Si tú no estás en su clase de casa cuarto, por favor, lo notifica tu maestro now. Go. Gracias. Ni men shen zai de ye jen jiao se yu si ni men de ya
jiao. This is April 1994.
Zai jiao.
Hey, Ho Chi Minh!
Put down that
Chinese menu and start talking American!
Bertram, I am in the middle of announcements. We can take this up
after
class.
You're confusing the white kids!
How many times do I have to explain to you? This school is a melting pot.
I'm gonna take a dump in your melting pot! Give me that goddamn microphone!
Do not take the microphone!
Attention, foreigners! In this country, we speak English! That's why we call it America!
Turn the microphone
on. I'm not taking orders from a goddamn... Attention, student body! Mr. Tomey is a flaming hope!
All right. Thank you, students. And once again, on behalf of the faculty and staff, welcome to Louis Pasteur Junior High School.
I think in the stage show, I would have left the stage and went like, oh, I had enough of this shit.
This is, as somebody who enjoys a one-man show, this could have been a big deal. I mean, you could have done this at Gary Marshall Theater. You could have done this.
Lin-Manuel
this could have traveled.
Well, Miranda, put your heart out.
John Mulaney and what's his name? The other one. They were on Broadway doing Oh Hello for 4 months.
Yeah. On the Kroll.
Thank you.
I think we were going to give everyone like a registration card when they came in. I was going to collect everyone's registration cards and call their names out.
In and of itself.
And do that whole thing.
That would have been so much fun.
Wow.
Yeah, I totally forgot about the part where I was like, comedically, when he was going into Mandarin, I was like, how long are we going to stay with this joke? But then I forgot I was going to interrupt the joke by barging in.
You could have a special celebrity guest every night that you berate.
Mm-hmm.
As one of the worst students.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't think we should be done with this. I like this too much.
Don't tell Mike August. He'll start booking clubs around the country with the Mr. Bertram show. But
featuring Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah. That was our opening announcement. If you showed up to the show that night, you were in the homeroom. Yeah. There were interesting kind of devices I remember now thinking about. All right. We have the OC marching
band. Chris found it.
Kids aren't all right.
I was probably at that game.
Well, if it was a home game.
That's right.
And it always is with the marching band.
When they do the more elaborate
setup.
They have a traveling, you know, smaller crew.
Mm-hmm. All the 19-year-old skilled guys on the offensive side of the ball are a little confused as to what we're doing here.
Suffice to say, it sounds more impressive over there.
Yeah, but what could be what could be better as a young student at USC, whatever the capacity was, is knowing that one day they would, the marching band would be playing your song at the football game.
How badass is that?
All right, well, remind Dexter that, because I've never gotten into that with him.
And he was conducting.
That probably not that game, but he had. I have been at games where it's like, please welcome Dexter Holland, and he's leading the band. It's fucking awesome.
All right, I have a question, a philosophical question, but I think this one is rooted in some reality. I'm obsessed with people's inability to sort of put things back or snap the lid on or rinse the mug out or screw the cap back on the ketchup before they put it in. And I've been conducting an informal survey ever since they invented the toothpaste with the cap snap lid on it.
Yep.
Because evidently there's an issue with people leaving the cap off.
Not snapping it back.
Not snapping it back. There was an issue with people leaving
the
cap off.
That's what engendered the snap.
I understand.
The cap would be.
Right.
Confusing to me that would be an issue.
And yet here we are.
So somebody decided to remedy it with the cap snap back toothpaste. I've noticed that those things are universally open amongst people that need it. And my hypothesis is you've actually exacerbated the problem.
Okay.
The people that left the cap off did it in a bit. They were about 40% leaving it off. They wouldn't do it every time. They would just do it some of the time. The cap flapped up. That seems to be in the 80s. I think there's actually more toothpaste dried out at the top. The point is the cap snap did not fix anything, could have exacerbated it.
Because it didn't fix us.
It didn't fix us. It didn't fix the person who needed
it.
Right. Now you'll never lose the cap. It's just there.
But no one ever lost the cap. They just set it down never put it back on. Unless you're brushing your teeth in some exotic way that involves, I like to hike and brush my, I mountain bike, I choose to brush my, and floss. So I think the bigger picture, as we talk about things on a more sort of global level, I think when you make things easier for people, it doesn't correct the problem. They just tend to, the people who were going to do it kind of do more of it anyway.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's like if you want a kid or an alcoholic or somebody to stop doing what they're doing, they don't just stop because you want them to. They find a sneaky way for you not to find out about it.
Yeah, I never buy the cap snap toothpaste because I have the same relationship with toothpaste as I do with the deodorant. I don't like the big corporate, like this has, these have flavor crystals and the orange stripe is for gum health and the blue stripe, that's for minty. It feels like one big chemical coming out of the tube. And I feel that way with the ultra red zone deodorant stuff where this is a gel and it's the ultimate. Ultra
Pro
Red
Max.
Zone, Pro Max. Yeah. I'm like, just get the Toms of Maine that smells like powder or something. And I'm that way with the toothpaste.
Yeah.
I don't know. You guys are you cap snappers?
Well, it's funny because I have the attached cap, but I do snap it down. But I have noticed anecdotally that in general with friends and family, the ones with the cap that's attached always has more encrusted toothpaste around it than the one that's left off. You know, either way, you could put it on or off. It's always just full of
crud. It's pretty egregious because if you leave it off, the toothpaste grows a hymen at that thing. And then you have to push it out and pop it out. And then you get this weird skin in your toothpaste.
Almost completely defeating the purpose of the snapback because it prevents, so much crust built up around it.
Yeah. Yes. So now somebody's going to have to invent a self-sealing toothpaste. And in that case, I don't know how this army of super lazy out of it people are going to defeat that, but they're going to do it.
That's a good point. You know how everybody loves a good hack these days, especially on social media. There's now a toothpaste hack. And I wouldn't have thought of it unless we had this conversation. One smart mom who's always on the go decided to put her kid's toothpaste in a soap pump. So they can just, and she thinks it will eliminate more. She said that's her hack.
Too viscous.
Yeah, that's dumb.
Wait a minute.
Maybe it's a gel. Does it help if it's a gel toothpaste?
It's got to be not as viscous as we're
Adam,
thinking.
I think I have your answer because they do for little kids. They make the fluoride-free like Hello toothpaste or the whatever toothpaste that is very liquidy.
Yes,
it's very gel.
Well, that must be the one they use. All right, now yes.
Can I, because we're talking about people that are kind of shitty and things that annoy us. Can I ask you if this has become a problem for either of you? Because I've noticed it a lot lately in my car and at the grocery store. Well, I know you don't do a lot of grocery shop, but okay, just picture this. You have your cart, you're trying to get down the aisle, somebody's kind of just in the aisle, kind of like just staring off into space or on their phone or just fucking around, not noticing. And the second they feel you trying to pass them, they speed up with their cart.
As though not to lose their spot.
Right.
To make an air cool.
Yes.
What is that? Because we know people do it in their cars, but people do it while they're walking now.
I was thinking about that, trying to merge onto the 405 today, which is... Who is it that doesn't feel the presence of other people? Like you're signaling and you're next to them and they're leaving too much space and they're not speeding up and they're not slowing down and you're trying to move over. And then at some point when you do, they give you a look like, what the fuck? Yeah. It's like you must feel when you're shifting from one freeway to another freeway that others are also trying to get on that freeway. Why don't you feel? And it's true. It's a feeling. They always talk about. Great quarterbacks in the NFL feel that pressure on their blind side. Mm. They don't see it. They kind of know it.
A hyper-awareness.
They know it's there.
And to Gina's point, like the last second hustle or like scramble to make up that tiny bit of ground, like as though if they cede that ground, they've lost the war. It's like you're checked out. Yeah. You're fine.
They're
whatever.
Dipshits.
All right. Hot breaking Love Boat news from 1981. More Halston talk.
Halston.
Also, a designer Halston. Also, somebody called into me and Dr. Drew's show today and had the, I told you, old and new. I brought up the tablet.
Right.
It's one of the single oldest things and single newest things. Brian had one.
The cloud.
The cloud
versus, you know, clouds. He brought up an old and new one, too. Not as big a span as the cloud or the tablet. The digital exam.
You mean... Wait.
I'll let Brian think about
okay.
it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Digital exam.
Oh, digital.
Right.
Like,
yes.
Oh, yeah. Digital exam.
Finger up the butt versus Drew doesn't use Scantron. Drew was telling me... whenever we flew together in 1997, 1990, he was constantly taking his Scantron exams on the plane. He was, he was constantly having to get recertified with everything all the time. And he was like, going to be on plane for 6 hours. Drew, you know, I'm going to drink and nap and watch a movie. He's going to use that downtime to work on his test, which always bothered me. But now he says they're all digital.
That's
well, the
good.
Temporal thermometer, you know, digital exam, just point at your head and know what your temperature is.
And somebody said, that's digital too. Yeah, somebody said the digital exam. And I thought to myself, well, what kind of window are we talking here? Like, when did they start dropping digits? When did they start doing checking prostates? You know?
And think about, like, when women were, quote unquote, hysterical,
you
which is where we got
and,
hysterectomies.
You
know, right. I said, I don't know. Has it been 150 years? I don't know.
Maybe.
One way, it struck me it didn't go back that far. So I was trying to think of it. And then I just said, what year was the latex glove invented? Because it'll be the next month.
Right.
That'll let us know because you're not going bareback with that digit and you're not going with the farmer's glove either.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? You would take you'd need a glove for that. Anyway, the latex glove, 1894.
Okay.
So I'm guessing that's when the digital exams begun.
Not to shit on your point, but there was a whole, I think, Mike Rowe podcast about the invisible killer, which was, you know, germs that nobody had ever heard of when doctors were delivering babies and then the next woman would die because they weren't washing their hands. So, I mean, digital could go back much farther.
I was going to say.
They just didn't realize why people were dying.
That should be a Ken Burns documentary series, like the history of medicine, right? Because, like George Washington, I was thinking to myself, how did George Washington die? Does anybody know know the story?
No.
Got a splinter in his gums from his wooden teeth?
Sadly, kind of mundane like that. He injured himself. He had been president, not been president for like 4 or 5 years, injured himself on his farm. Not a major injury, but bad enough that they were, you know, had to tend to it, and they did bloodletting back in the day, and they let too much blood, and our greatest president died.
From leeches.
Yeah, he got infected. I think the guy who designed the Brooklyn Bridge, if I'm not mistaken, cut his toe or something, like on the dock when something back then that just went back home, got infected, and
tetanus.
Just died.
Yeah. Brutal.
Yeah, all right. The digital rectal exam, Max Zapata. How far back does that go?
Do a video search.
Also, Halston from The Love Boat.
Yes, please.
So Drew and I were going over to the Love Boat episode where all the designers came on, and we're talking about Halston, who was gay, and Halston died of AIDS in 1990. Makes perfect sense. And he's a gay designer,
right?
And just like I told you, even though it was the 80s, they wouldn't let the white man and the black woman kiss at the railing,
right? They hugged it out.
Everyone else who falls in love kiss. This is network TV in the 80s. They didn't recognize gay either. And to prove it, when Halston came onto the ship, I'll play the clip. You tell me. And I don't know if he would have protested or went like, I'm gay, or I don't want to be perceived as hetero. But here's the clip of Halston coming onto the ship. He's got a bevy of models with him.
Hey, who's that lucky guy?
How do you do? I'm Halston.
I'm happy to have you with us. Did you know that Halston is the first American designer to bring high fashion to mainland China?
Yes, every now and again, it is good to get out of the office.
I certainly like the way you travel.
You pack the same way I do, only take what you need.
Just the bare essentials.
Oh, boy.
8 years later, he's taken by AIDS. But he had to stand in front of a five waif model, the guitar girls.
Pawing him.
Pretend like he wanted to have sex with them. And they had to make a big deal. I like the way you travel. Woo!
Only the essentials.
What was the conceit? Like, hey, when people get on the ship, we all got to gather at the front of the ship when people get on and then rate the women who are coming onto the ship. Like, if she's a single dude, we'll do, if it's a single chick, like a hot chick coming on, then we'll do a rock, paper, scissors game to figure out who's going to fuck her.
Right.
But if she's with someone, we'll just give the guy the big thumbs up, do the finger in the hole thing. Yeah. Save some of that shit for me.
Right.
This is the crew of the ship.
Yeah.
This is the doctor and the captain and the purser.
They don't play it close to the vest.
No, they did not back then.
Must have got so much pussy that night.
Now, he must have been, I don't know, was he out? He was always gay. I told Chris to look it up. And
he was probably New York out.
I was going to say, in that community, it doesn't matter much.
Right.
Right. All right. We got that. Vinny's going to join us in a second. Let me tell you about Keeps. There are only two FDA-approved medications to prevent hair loss. Keeps offers you both. Keeps, a simple, stress-free way to keep your hair. Convenient virtual doctor consultations and medications delivered straight to your door. You just do it online, and you get the discreet packaging every 3 months. It'll show up. Low cost treatments start at just $10 per month. Remember how expensive this stuff used to be? Proven results. Keeps has more 5-star reviews than its competitors. Check it out, and you can check out their before and after promo photos as well. Prevention is the key. Treatment can take 4 to 6 months to see results, so act fast. Right, Dawson?
If you're ready to take action and prevent hair loss, go to KEEPS.com/Adam to receive your first month of treatment for free. That's KEEPS.com/Adam to get your first month free. KEEPS.com/Adam.
All right, take a quick break. We'll talk to the great Vinny Tortorich about all the Frankenstein meat products that are coming up, or non-meat products, right after this. We'll be right back.
Do you want to be a part of Adam's next book?
Shit yeah!
Submit your questions for Ask an Asshole by emailing them to askhole@adamcarolla.com. Ask about any topic you need the Ace Man's advice or answers on. That's askhole@adamcarolla.com.
Vinny Tortorich has joined us. The documentary, Fat, a Documentary 2. It's available now on Amazon Prime Video and iTunes. So everyone listen to Vinny, would you please? And I'll tell you more about his NSNG foods and vitamins, supplements, and all that. First, good to see you, Vinny.
Great to see you guys. And by the way, I'm glad you brought up Fat, a Documentary 2. Yesterday, I didn't check today, but I just did a casual check yesterday because it's been out since January 1st. It was at 17 on iTunes and documentaries. So people are paying attention to this stuff, and it makes me happy that they are because those movies make enough money for me so that I can go out and make another movie.
Well, you're doing the Lord's work. And, you know, I think once you give your sermon, people like Gina and people like Brian and people like myself never stop preaching what you're preaching, which is it's kind of the ultimate, because, you know, you go to an Herbalife meeting and when you're done, you don't walk away going, I got to tell everyone what I know. And there's many versions of that. But when Vinny speaks, people listen, and they should. And we need it more than ever in this country. I stumbled on as we're going to talk about the evolution of food and Impossible Burgers and all these meat substitute products and everything like that. I stumbled earlier today onto an old school food commercial from the 70s of how this country used to roll as it pertained to meat. Nope. Max Pata, you got it? It's a blast from the past. Chopping wood.
Lumberjack.
A man can pile up a roaring appetite this way.
How do you handle a hundred
men? Yes. The manhandlers.
One of the manhandlers is
chili
Campbell's beef
Scotch
soup.
Rock.
A sturdy soup with whole grain.
Sturdy.
Bites of beef and lots of vegetables. Mmm. Good.
The manhandlers.
Now there's just some dude with a man bun.
The manhandlers.
Wow.
Eating an Impossible Burger and talking about his pronouns.
Wow.
Yeah, we've come a long way. Those were food commercials when I grew up. The manhandler.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of that. You know, I actually still chop wood, and I can tell you, you're not going to chop something that big with just an axe. You're going to need a splitter.
Okay. Yeah.
And, you know... Yeah, I love that. It's like, who started that piece of wood for that guy? Because something that big needs a splitter.
The same guy who used to breathe on the boards that Elvis karate chopped in half before he got his black belt.
Right.
That dude was breathing on those logs. He fluffed those logs.
What the hell is Scotch broth?
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing.
I don't know. It sounds gay to me. Like, I'm going to give him the scotch, the scotch broth, and then I left the motel.
Brought to you by the manhandlers.
The manhandler.
Scotch broth is a filling soup from Scotland. Principal ingredients are barley, stewing or braising, cuts of lamb, mutton or beef, root vegetables, and dried pulses.
Beef and barley.
So not an NSNG.
It's
kind of like a Scotch egg. There's nothing NSNG about a Scotch egg.
What is what's going on with the Franken meat substitute stuff that's we're seeing all over the place?
Well, you know, look, just like when I wrote my book over 10 years ago, I was loath to put the word ketogenic in it because I knew everyone would think I was basically a flat earther. It's like he's telling everyone to go into ketoacidosis. And so, you know, now it's pretty much ubiquitous. You know, people just, you see it everywhere. Everyone's doing low carb. Gina's doing it again. And, and people are losing weight and it works. And then I came around a few years later and said, hey, we need to be off. It's not just any fat. You got to be off of seed oils. And everybody's like, what is this you speak of? And it turns out now everyone's coming around on that.
Vinny, let me jump on that point because I was in the Cedars-Sinai Cancer Center Infusion Center yesterday for the first time in 3 years, and I noticed some differences. And they typically give out a menu. You know, if you're there for hours at a time, they'll give you a snack or food or whatever. And on the menu now, the new menu, they have a little section. It's not called keto. It's not called NSNG, but it's called like high protein, and it's basically keto snacks. Like they have hard boiled eggs. And they have cheese sticks and hummus and, you know, things that are obviously not sandwiches and crackers and whatnot. And it's nice to see them kind of, when I talked to the nutritionist, came around, like, hi, I'm the nutritionist, can I take your order? I'm like, yeah, I'm doing keto, so I'll just do cheese stick and eggs, you know. And she's like, oh, okay, very good. So they're on board.
Where are we with hummus? I feel like you've gave a thumbs down on that one in the past.
Well, if hummus is done without seed oil, then you're okay. And then, you know, hummus is basically taking beans and mushing them into baby food. That's what hummus is. So it can get a bit carby, but if you want to go, look, hummus is one of those things, if you're having a small amount of hummus with anything, that's fine. No one sits there and just hammers a whole plate of hummus. Right. Mm-hmm. So
I'd like to.
You know, I'm okay if you're having hummus along with something else. So that's fine. But it's just not, it's going to be somewhat carby. You could take a lot of things. Almonds are a perfect example. A handful of almonds won't kill you, but you go, wait, Vinny says almonds are good. Therefore, I'm going to take almonds now and turn it into almond meal or almond milk. Now you're turning it into a carby mess.
What about almond butter?
Almond butter is okay, but you got to be careful, you know, because a scoop or two is fine. But if you go, Vinny says I can have all the almonds I want, and you just start hammering almonds. As you know, in my product, my Ultra Fat, I have almonds in there, but it's mixed in with a medium chain triglyceride, a coconut oil, to, you know, now you have a higher fat food. So that makes it okay.
Well, couple things. First off, whoever hummus's publicist is, we need to hire that firm.
It's been a good run.
When I, you know, 25 years ago, hummus was a terrorist group. They're fighting hummus? Israel, right? Yeah. No, these are chickpeas and garbanzo beans that are mashed into mush
with a little paprika on top.
Fuck that. Are we out of bean dip? Like, what? I'm not going to eat that shit. We got salsa. We got guac. We got bean dip. We got seven-layer dip.
Trader Joe and Big Hummus sailing into the sunset.
Now everyone's into hummus. Like, everyone fucking loves hummus. Also, was consider anything when I was a kid, you saw the Manhandler commercial. Oh, that's what I would watch. Boy, but any Middle Eastern food was considered weirdo food,
exotic
and weird. Yeah.
Then how in the hell did the phrase like two-tone halva become a thing?
Two-tone halva?
Halva or halva, yeah.
Oh, you Jews got to make everything your own word, don't
you? But you've heard that. Yeah. Like, oh, it's, you know, instead of sliced bread.
Halva was...
Everyone in our family was like, oh, that's the greatest thing since two-tone
halva.
Well,
you can eat sand, so halva's fine.
Was not bandied around thing? North Hollywood in the 70s.
They did not make it out to the coast.
Just at the synagogue, okay.
So, Vinny, what about... And first off, first things first. Once you start getting into these seed oils... Mm-hmm. You start reading the packaging on anything, it's a Pop Secret popcorn, whether it's like, it drives me nuts when they give like Nature's Choice, no GMOs, butter spreads, it's all
grape seed,
everything's just seed oil everywhere. All the time.
You know what Trader Joe's has embraced in the last year? New product, the sprayable avocado oil.
Oh, I use that.
I've used that.
I should get stock
in
that.
It's pretty awesome.
I use it a lot. It has a high smoke point.
So this, you suspect maybe the seed oil. Look, if you're an average American and you're just, you know, eating fast food and eating chips and just buying the popcorn and buying the butter-like spread and stuff, you must be consuming vast amounts of seed oil. It must literally just be everywhere.
It's literally killing people. It's that bad for you. And it's the same companies that, you know, Unilever, Cargill, JBS, which is in the news right now because they've been, I think they've been cyber attacked or whatever.
Oh, the meat
Smithfield,
plant.
Tyson. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, all of these companies... I started working on my next documentary. All my interviews are in a can now. I'm laying everything out. I'm putting it together. It will be out before the end of this year, but I'm going after the fake meat industry, and I'm going whole hog. And as a matter of fact, unlike vegan documentaries where they'll never have a guy like me, I invited the top vegan doctors to be in this documentary. Everyone had a dumber excuse than the one before. I asked Walter Willett, who's on all these boards, right? I asked Gregor.
Yeah.
I asked McDougal. Gregor was one of my favorites. I said, would you like to be in my movie? And he wrote back, I'm busy that day. And I wrote back and said, I didn't give you a date. I just asked if you wanted to be in it. It's still open-ended.
Whatever day it is.
But they all gave me dumb excuses as to why they couldn't be in this movie. I'm trying to get to the truth. So I'm trying to get people to talk on both sides. I'm not trying to put out some propaganda film, but it's interesting. Walter Willett will not be in this movie because he's in bed with Unilever. He's in bed with this whole new way of eating. We have words out there. These are the questions for my movie. I still have them on my desk. You know, I'm asking, you know, about these new terms we have, like planetary health diet. You know, a planetary health diet. You know, I'm trying to figure out how we're trying to figure out that these fake meats are okay, because they're saying, number one, we're going to save the planet. Okay, that's not going to happen, because most of these ingredients come from where? Let's see, a little place called, you might have heard of it. It's called, China. So number one, we're getting the stuff out of China. All of the meat companies, they're hedging their bets. Tyson is, JBS is, Cargill, they're all putting Unilever. They're dropping billions of dollars, not together, each, into this, because they know that this is where we're heading.
Can I chime in?
Yeah.
Well, there may be, so there's a couple thoughts, you know, because we're living in this time, which is sort of how do you get everyone to do everything? And you just say it's about the environment, it's about global warming or climate change or whatever. It's interesting that climate change has also had a racist overtone grafted onto it too. Now there's climate change and racism. They're not really separate subjects. You've heard it talked about a little bit. But somebody has figured out the best way to get shit done is to call everything racist. And if climate change has a racial component to it, and these fake meats will essentially stop climate change, and they're also going to stop one form of racism as well. This is how you get the masses in. This is how you gather up all the young teen girls and get them on the fake fucking meat train. So be prepared. It won't be, I was thinking about this today, it's not going to be eat this meat substitute, it's good for you. It's going to be eat this meat substitute, save the planet, and don't be a racist.
Right.
That's where I think a lot of this is going to go. And one step further, and then we'll circle back. You talk about these big companies, and they're all diversifying, but they're just big companies who want to make money. Right. And in a way, it's kind of like what big car companies are doing now with electric cars. They figured out which way the wind is blowing. They also figured out which way we're going politically. Sure. They figure out they're going to get a fuckload of incentives and lots of money from the government, and that everyone wants to be on the right side of the administration. So they start proactively sometimes and reactively other times going, oh, we're going to switch. And the next thing you know, we got Biden down at the plant. And I like electric cars, but I'm just saying, don't think they're doing it for reasons other than profit. Right. And I'm sure a lot of stuff is heading their way. But go ahead and touch on those two thoughts, Vinny. Thank you.
Yeah, you know, the racist part is almost weak compared to other parts of it, because I can make an argument that if you're worried about people of color in this country, they have the worst diet, right? And we're pumping more of that crap into their neighborhoods than anywhere else. So that, when I hear that, I want to just pull whatever hair I have left. Let me see. I got to get this Keeps company on the phone when I'm done here. It makes me want to pull the rest of my hair out, number one. The one that gets me is on the vegan side of it, where they're telling people, well, you don't want to kill sentient beings, do you? But you don't want to see. No, nobody wants to see anything die. But guess what? in order to eat a head of lettuce, in order to put a plow in the ground, something had to die. And if you go, oh, okay, a couple of bugs died. Oh, no. Go look at what a combine picks up every day. And I'm not talking about the NFL combine. I'm talking about combines that the harvesters that pick up all the wheat and all the grain and everything else. They pull buckets, 5-gallon buckets of frogs out of it every day. Most of it gets ground up into that, and that's going into your body. So vegans, if you think you're getting no meat by eating that crap, you're getting frogs, you're getting rats, you're getting ground squirrels, you're getting chipmunks. They have to go out at night and kill wild hogs. They go out at night and kill deers. You don't see all this stuff, right? But it's all happening. You think you're saving the planet, and you're not. You're making the planet worse. And if you don't have ruminants going around crapping and pissing all over the earth, you're killing that ground. We need this to happen. And they're telling you, it's almost like it's this weird cognitive dissonance where they're telling us what we're seeing is the wrong thing. We need to see something else. And that makes absolutely no sense. Did I make sense there?
Yeah. Yes. I'm glad you said cognitive dissonance, because the thing I can't square, and I'm wondering if anyone can help me understand it, I'm guessing no one in this conversation will be able to, but when people have talked for so long about, you know, Frankenfood is bad, GMO is bad, you know, food that's made in a lab is bad, bad, bad. We don't want that. The same people are headed towards and supporting and cheering on Impossible Burgers. How is that possible? How do you square that?
Well, because they look, when, like I said, when you're Cargill or JBS or Tyson or Unilever, you have a little something called money, and you can start running campaigns across Facebook and Twitter and, you know, across all of it, Instagram, TikTok, and all of it, and convince people, Gina, the woman you sit with in your podcast, Easy yeah. Listening, thinks that being a vegan is a good thing. She thinks Michael Greger is a good guy. Oh. Has she ever seen Michael Greger? The guy looks like he's 10 inches away from death.
Vinny has thoughts about
46. He looks like he's 96.
Teresa, oh, she's gone vegan?
doesn't eat a lot of meat.
Well, what's in these products, Vinny, and what can we look forward to? Like, what's coming down the line? And then, see, I don't want to be all,
Motor City
Ted
Madman.
Nugent on you, but like they start with, well, why don't we do meatless Mondays? And then they'll go, okay, well, what are the kids going to eat on Monday? Well, we have a meat substitute, whatever. And they're not going to leave it at Monday. It's going to go Monday and Wednesday, yeah. And then it'll go Monday, Wednesday, Friday. That's my take. But
before I tell you what's in it, it's even worse than that. You know, we had people running on the platform in the last presidential election in this country on the Green New Deal. And if you look at the food side of it, they're talking not only Meatless Monday, but that organization I was just talking about, they're telling you 7 grams of beef per person per week. That's 1 gram per day. That's the size of a cube of cheese. That's what they want you to eat per day in meat.
Right.
Can you imagine this?
You just fill your meat with ice cube trays?
Already we have sperm countdown. We got boys looking like girls. We got every other problem in the world. And this is where our politicians who are getting money from these companies like from Eat Lancet, who's getting it from Unilever and everywhere else. And they're saying this is a good thing. And the politicians are dumb. They're going to say whoever gives them money, they're going to say that.
Well, it's kind of like every Green New Deal, every green whoever, every climate person, every single one of those people, like you go, well, this is going to affect black and brown people more because all those restaurants and it's all moving. It's like nuclear energy. We have safe nuclear energy. We could do it reliably. We could create a bunch of energy. We wouldn't be destroying the environment. They're all against it. So you can't ask them to be consistent or make sense. But what are in those burgers or those meatless products so we can gross everyone out?
They try to color it up. They have something they call heme, and God only knows how they're getting to it. Now, they were doing it with beet juice, but they're figuring out other ways to do that.
For people who don't know, Vinny, because a long time ago when this first came out, Brian and I tried it, remember, on the show?
Yeah, side by side.
And heme is basically, they're getting the fake meat to have the blood component that a burger has. Sort of mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what heme is, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They're using grains, they're using, and by the way, if you think grains are processed now, they're ultra processed in this new thing. They're using seed oils, the aforementioned seed oils, and they're pulling all this together with soybeans, which soybeans should not be consumed by humans. Most of the soybeans in the world, I got a soybean farmer in my next movie talking about where the soybeans go. It goes to feed mostly pigs. But the soybeans consumed by everyone else causes inflammation. So they're mixing all this stuff in with soybeans and grains and seed oils, and then they're mixing in color, and they're calling this good for your health. There's actually no redeeming quality of value to it at all. Not even kind of. You can't even squint and get to it's good for you. It's not good for you. You're better off with Fruity Pebbles all day long. I'm not making this up.
I heard Vinny say you Fruity Pebbles.
Yep. Headline. Isn't it kind of diabolical and interesting that these companies, from what I remember, they didn't go to grocery stores to the individual consumer. They went to fast food chains. So that's kind of interesting. That's an interesting business model. So instead of, you know, I don't think we can, or we can maybe now, but at first you couldn't buy the stuff in the grocery store, but you could get the burger at Burger King, or you could get the, you know, whatever at Chick-fil-A or whatever. That was an interesting way to infiltrate the market.
Gina, to that point, Beyond Meat has partnered with Pepsi, McDonald's, Pizza Hut, KFC, and several others. Mm. Yeah. That tells you everything you need to know.
Yeah.
And who's eating that? Who's eating that mostly? Poor people.
Yeah.
And people, you know, if that racist, it's the opposite of what they're saying. It that's what's so mind boggling. They're selling this and it's the opposite of what they're saying.
Yeah. Well, the next step is when Vinny tries to put his new doc out and advertise it on Twitter, Facebook, and they pull it down.
Yeah, violating community standards.
False information. Yeah. Vinny, Dexter from The Offspring is waiting here. Did he drive his custom van?
Yes.
Woo! Oh, good.
Take a look.
All right.
Get the long mic cord.
Fat, a documentary, part two, and the website, vinnytortorich.com. You can go there for all the great products as well. Pure Vitamin Club. I took mine this morning. Pure Coffee Club as well. I had that this morning. Vinny, thanks for joining us. We'll talk very soon, my friend. All right. Let's see. Let me tell you about Humble. Based out of a CBD, by the way, based out of Southern California, Humble makes insanely great hemp-derived CBD products for any occasion. Humble is committed to helping you stay grounded no matter what life brings. Their line of CBD products is geared to help you focus, relax, and recover. Only for my listeners, Humble is offering 25% off your first order. You just use the code Adam to save on your entire order site-wide with all the different products they have. So go on to Humble, and you go to www.humblecbd.com. Choose any of their products that meet your needs. And again, 25% off site-wide to my listeners only. Stay grounded with Humble CBD. All right, good news. Dexter Holland is going to join us right after this. Spring has joined us. Always good to see you, my friend.
You too. Thank you.
You drove the custom van out?
I do. I do.
All right. We'll get into all the music in a second. Yeah. But first, the van.
Yeah.
The choice of the van. A man like you, a discerning rock and roll gentleman like you, could afford to drive any vehicle.
Right.
You choose the van. Now, you're not driven in the van.
No. I drive it myself. It's my daily driver.
It's badass. We're looking at it. We talk about it a lot.
Yeah.
Why is that? Why the fascination with...
Well, I'm a car guy, and I guess a van guy now, although I never really thought of myself as a van. No one says I'm a van guy because people think you're a pedophile.
Right.
You got to go, I'm a car guy that's really tall and has tinted windows and long where you can...
Lay down.
Plenty of room for the kids.
I realize that maybe it seems odd to drive a van, but I really like them, and the kids love them.
Mm-hmm.
My dad drove one. That's probably part of it.
What was he doing? What was his van thing?
He had a conversion kind of thing like that also.
Really?
Back in the 70s. It was red with big, stripes and stuff.
Oh. Was it family road trip worthy?
It was. Yeah. Did that a little bit.
What'd your dad do?
He was a hospital administrator, so he worked at General Hospital in L.A.
You always hear the guys with the coolest vans are hospital administrators.
Yeah, true. But I like that it's unique. No one's driving vans. They're driving, Escalades or whatever. But I think this is the next thing, the next level.
All I hear when I hear a dad like your dad's, I hear good dad. That sounds like a good dad to me because he factored in the family on the van purchase.
For sure.
So I like that the torch has now been passed to you.
That's right.
And now you can the next generation of van drivers is amongst us.
Correct.
And then there's the hot sauce, which I eat, I'd say, on a daily basis. I had fish tacos last night and had the Gringo Bandito hot sauce on there. How's that business going?
It's going good. Pandemic was good for grocery, turns out.
Oh, yeah.
So, a banner year.
And the story that I love is I believe your nanny or housekeeper or whatever that job was, when it was time to retire her, you liked her so much, you said, what's a business we can do together?
That's right. My daughter went off to college, and I had no use for the nanny, but she was so great. I'm like, we got to find something. Let's make a hot sauce.
That's cool. And so into the van you guys went.
That's
and
right.
Off to buy the ingredients.
Off in the
get
sunset.
The peppers, yeah.
Are you guys in...
Olga's Goulash Shop coming soon.
Yeah, because I got the same thing. Although I think my nanny's actually going to college with the
doctor. Oh, really?
Oh, that makes sense.
That would cost me more.
Yeah. She'll do the classes.
So is it... I've seen it in restaurants now. I've seen it in a lot of supermarkets now. A lot of different flavors and offerings now.
Yes. We have four flavors now.
Mm-hmm. And are you guys sort of nationwide now?
Yeah. Yeah. Kind of a grocery chain kind of thing. All the Kroger's, which is Ralph's and whatever.
God. So what we got is we got rock and roll, and then we got flying airplanes, and then we got hot sauce.
Don't forget the vans.
And don't forget the
molecular and we got the vans and we got the biology. Yeah. Let's talk about the education for a second. Did you recently get your degree?
3 years ago.
I remember talking about it before.
Yeah.
And why? Why the emphasis?
I was halfway there when the band broke back in the 90s. And so I always kind of wanted to go back and finish it and finally decided to do it.
And is there a practical application for you? Like your dad would give you a gig at the hospital he runs or something? Park your van next to mine, son. Come on down.
I mean, I hope to fit it in somewhere. I don't know exactly. I could maybe do a paper here and there or something. But, I liked it.
I was looking at your, it's a thesis or dissertation?
Yeah, same thing.
Okay. I was looking at it. And I don't understand shit about it, but I was looking at it. I realized that it probably had gave you some insight into coronavirus because there seemed to be some crossover there. Did you, when it came around, were you like, I know what this is?
For sure. My focus was HIV on the virus. So there were some similarities, I guess. Spike protein and stuff.
Did
mRNA and, or what, am I getting that right?
Yeah.
I saw that in the headline.
People, by the way, the album Let the Bad Times Roll, it's available wherever you listen to music. Dexter was nice enough to send me a kind of early version of the song and the video a month ago, I think. And you guys should watch the video as well. It's a really good video.
In a
day when I don't know if everyone's making videos, this was quite... ambitious.
Like a real video.
Like a real video. Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like it was important to have a video component for every song on the record. I don't know if people are really doing that, but I wanted to do it for ours.
What's the touring schedule? And by the way, the Offspring or just Dexter, I'm not sure, are going to be playing our barbecue wherever that, didn't you have that on? Oh yeah, Corolla Drinks Barbecue coming up in August. So,
oh, nothing.
That's one tour date. Well, yeah. I think it's sold out, but so I'm not plugging it too hard. But what's the touring like now that we're coming out of the COVID?
I was going to say sliding, but it looks like it's dates are holding now. So our first thing's not till September, but I know a lot of bands are going out July and August, so it feels like it's rolling now.
Is it going to be a full tour?
We just have sporadic dates. Our first real thing is in the UK in November. So I think it'll be really mostly next year for a full on.
And what's the prep for that?
Band practice? Like, is that what you mean? Or
yeah,
like,
I mean, I
dance lessons, I, choreographer.
I don't know. You tell me, because you're the PhD. But most guys, a lot of guys get into comedy because they're lazy, and a lot of guys get into music and other things because they don't like homework. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Like, not Dexter.
I remember million years ago when I were doing some benefit, some like PETA benefit or something that Bill Maher asked me to do at the Improv. We're going to do, he had this singer. It's like, he'll be Dr. Drew and I'll be Adam Carolla. And we'll do a love line thing. We'll just hop up on stage and we'll do a love line thing. And I was watching all these other comedians doing like a tight 8 minutes, mm-hmm. you know, really seasoned, good professional comedians, because Bill Maher got all the A-listers mm-hmm. out and it was just funnier than shit and 10 minutes long. And I was like starting to get nervous, and I was like, what are we going to do up there, Bill? And he goes, I don't know. We'll just kind of wing it or whatever. And I was like, I don't know. It doesn't feel like we should just go up there and wing it. Yeah. You got a full crowd and everyone's doing joke after joke. And I go, he goes, oh, why don't we go outside and talk about it and figure it out. And I'm like, okay, good. Let's figure out what we're going to do. And then we went outside. He smoked a joint. We didn't talk about it at all. And then when he's done smoking a joint, we went back in. And I was like, that's not preparation. Now you're high.
Now he's in the zone.
He's ready.
I'm more scared to get up on stage. But that's preparation.
Right.
Like, and so when you're with a band and you've been at it for as long as you've been at it, you don't want to show up on stage and be rusty and shitty and out of whatever. But on the other hand, how disciplined, like how can you put in 5-hour right. practice sessions, and can you do them multi days in a row? And
I don't enjoy band practice. I mean, we've played these songs, you know, 1,000 times, right? So usually on a tour, we are kind of lazy. We'll go, well, the first night's just, you know, Fresno. So
right.
can you please have a book about touring and call it that?
Yeah, no, wait, I can't say that. No, but sometimes the first couple nights you're a little rusty, and that's okay, because I mean it comes back quickly and stuff. But I mean, this time we've been off for a year, and we're going to try to, you know, we're going to spend some time and try to step it up.
But you're incorporating at least one new band member, right?
That's right. Yeah, Todd. Well, Todd was with us as a backup guy, so he's been okay. with the group for a while, but now he's on bass.
Gotcha. That's what I meant, because I figure he's gonna learn, not learn the new songs, but just, you know, get in the rhythm and get.
But he's been
in the rhythm.
He's been a swing, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, for sure. So,
well, nothing says I can rock freestyle more than the name Todd.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's a guy who doesn't need rehearsal. He's
That's
just
right.
going to slam some heroin
That's
and
right.
get up on stage and light his guitar on fire.
Right.
And just that guy doesn't need to be coached up. That's Todd.
He's thanking you in advance right now.
Oh, Todd.
Speaking of live prep, so yesterday on the show, we had we saw a viral video of Vince Neil performing live, and it didn't go so well. He lost his voice, and he sings in a higher register. Obviously, it's catching up with him. I don't know if he takes care of himself so well. And I'm wondering, oh, Dexter's coming in tomorrow. You sing in a higher register
yeah.
exclusively. How do you physically tear the voice? Is there a routine, a regimen?
Are you going to have to stop in the middle of Girls, Girls, Girls?
I hope not. No, is that what happened
yeah.
earlier?
Yeah. Oh, he wow. said, my voice just gave out. I got to go. Sorry.
He had the whole backing track going, which I'm guessing you frown upon.
Right, right.
We can play it for
no,
you.
This is what happened.
Oh.
But it must be a back, as Dawson said, there must be a backing track playing.
Boone, Iowa, we're not
this
happy.
It's that Southwest commercial, Want to Get Away, and they show the bass player who's singing Girls, Girls, Girls while the lead guy's walking off stage. Like, Want to Get Away?
That's great. You know, like, that just isn't working for me tonight. I'm out. See you guys. Good night.
Have you ever had a situation where, like, first off, sometimes shit happens, like, you know, the guy falls off stage or his voice goes out or lighting rig crushes you or something. The band, there's doesn't seem to be a correct way to handle that. They don't stop at the same time. Right. They don't know what to do. They tend to just keep playing.
Didn't Dave Grohl break his leg on stage?
Yeah.
And he finished the set.
Yeah,
he finished
Bono the set. Walked off the stage many years. Well, literally fell off the stage many years ago.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, the thing about being on tour is you can't call in sick. I mean, no matter what. If you're, you know, I think I have canceled two shows over the years because it was almost like laryngitis. There was just nothing there. Like, if you're hoarse, you go on. If you sound shitty, you go on. And that's just what you have to do.
Do you have a regimen, though? Because the voice is unique.
Yeah, I started warming up a long time ago because I was getting hoarse a lot. So just the warm-up helps a lot. I do it for, like, I don't know, 20 minutes or half an hour before the set. Just kind of go through your stuff. And that helps a lot. Also, we don't play too many shows in a row. I think that, you know, back in the day, like, oh, put these 6 nights a week, you know, sure. But now it's just like I try not to do more than two.
Do you have your warm-up thing that you do that we can – embarrass you?
Is it like choir scales? Is that kind of like?
It's
kind of
like la 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 la. Yeah.
I am so magnanimous. I go you.
That is so
sweet. I don't like to make it about myself. That's right. But I'll bet Dexter does me, doesn't he?
Yes. Always.
Are you flying? What's going on with you and your aircraft world, which I'm always interested in?
Yeah, yeah, I'm flying. I took the family to Honduras last week, actually, which was great.
Oh, me too.
As you do.
What equipment you fly? Oh, me too.
Yeah. I have the Citation. It's a CJ-1.
I think I saw you up there.
Oh, yeah, on the ramp.
I waved. You didn't see me.
Yeah. You took the family to Honduras last weekend?
Yeah, last week.
CJ-1's a big plane.
It's
right? It's not a Boeing 747, but it's a little tiny jet.
It's small for, you know, a business jet, I guess. Two in the front and six in the back.
And is it single engine?
No, twin.
Oh, twin. Oh, we're looking at it. Okay.
That's what one looks like.
Yeah. And range 1,400 miles or something? What's the range?
1,150 nautical, so about 1,300 miles.
Oh, I was way off.
Yeah, pretty good. Wow. I'm impressed. You know your stats.
Well, I have Mark Garrigo says a big jet and a small jet. Yeah. And I always have to figure out which jet could make it to Nashville and which jet could make it to New York. You know, there's a lot of that.
We sometimes use the same charter pilot, and he actually asked to use my jet. And so he chartered it last week and went to Cabo or something.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So I wasn't sure how I felt about having Mark Garrigo in my plane. I'm sure he's a nice guy.
Very nice guy.
Lots of private jets at the Anarchy on the fin.
It's you, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you, so flew the family to Honduras?
Why? Why Honduras?
Look at the Caribbean vibe. Mm-hmm. I like to dive, too, and I was getting my 16-year-old rated.
But not while you're flying. It's a little comedy. It's a pilot comedy
joke. Yeah, you guys understand it. We don't get it. Yeah.
Yeah. So flying, how does one fly to Honduras?
Yeah, well, I can't make it nonstop in that plane. So we go to really the bottom, the tip of Texas. It's called Brownsville. Mm-hmm. So you're still in the U.S. for the first half. And then you fill up, and it's about another 2.5 or 3 hours straight to Roatan, is where I went. It's an island off the coast of Honduras.
And how does the navigation, like, work in that situation?
Yeah, I mean, you're on with controllers. You file a flight plan ahead of time, and I even use a company, because they'll say, well, this is the right way to go. Don't just try to pick it out yourself, you know.
Wing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they said, file this flight plan. You're on with the controller, so it's not hard.
Will you punch that into the autopilot?
Mm-hmm.
And so it'll correct you, or it knows where to go.
It does, yeah.
And it knows where all the commercial traffic is and everything, too, right?
Yeah, I got traffic in the plane, sure.
Are you guys a little above the commercial stuff?
I can go a little above it. It kind of depends on a bunch of things, but we're generally with it. I mean, air traffic control's job is to separate you also, so you don't
gotta keep them separated. It's another pilot joke.
How embarrassing.
That's a good one. I haven't heard that one.
That was cringy.
So are you taking off from where, like Orange County?
I base in Long Beach.
Uh-huh. Wow. That's it. How exotic does that sound? We're flying
pretty
to
awesome.
Honduras and Dexter's piloting.
And not so he can have a pina colada on the beach so you can go diving.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
They did
and a pina colada. Yeah, after a long day of diving.
Yeah, sure.
Wow. I never even thought about what it would take. Is Honduras cool? Is it safe? Is it fine?
Yeah, it was all right. I mean, it's, you know, it's definitely out there. It's remote and stuff, but I found it to be very safe.
Do you stay at a resort or camp, or what do you do there?
A hotel there that's nice and kind of small and stuff. I saw the bass player for Creedence Clearwater there.
Damn.
Wow.
Of all the gin joints.
Wow.
I know. I didn't say hi to him. I felt bad going up to him being that guy, but he was there.
Do you know what he looks like?
No. Well, a guy came up and told me. I thought I was being, you know, indiscreet, and some guy goes, "Hey, Dex," you know. So they,
oh, they knew
and he
you.
Said, "By the way, that's Stu Cook over there." So, but I remember him from, you know, the '70s album, so
sure.
I had to look him up on Google and look at his, you know, current day.
Oh,
and that's
his vibe.
Oh, there he is.
Yeah,
Stu.
Yeah,
yeah. Brown. Now, Stu, that's a rock and roll name. Todd.
Yeah. I have to talk to him about that.
Yeah. Well, you just call him the Toddster, Big Todd, or T-Dog. T-Man, or
T-Dog,
or something,
yeah.
You know,
sure.
When you're thanking
T-Money.
Him on stage. You can't go Todd.
We called him Gitod for a while.
Ooh,
oh,
yeah.
Okay.
There, you're way ahead.
Now yeah. We're warming up.
Yeah. Brownsville, Texas, Dawson, there's a band. Named after Brownsville.
Brownsville Station?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Who sung
Smoking in the Boys Room?
Who was
Motley Crue
by
covered
Motley
it.
Crue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
We're coming.
Yeah, Vince had to quit in the middle of that song.
I was this old when I found out that was not a Motley Crue song.
Oh, no.
Oh, really?
Yep. Yeah.
Brownsville Station.
Oh, who knew? I guess everybody else. I thought that was a Motley Crue song.
So Dexter, sorry. Well, are we missing anything? We got the flying... We got the hot sauce. We got the van.
PhD.
We got the rock and roll. We got the PhD. Well, so here's a question. What do you want to do that you're not doing? Because some people are curious. Some people aren't curious. I'm curious about people who aren't curious, but there seems to be more people who aren't curious than are curious. But then curious people are always getting into the next thing. So what's kind of, I mean, diving, flying, you know.
Yeah.
What's next for you, or what are you thinking about?
Triathlons.
Really?
Yeah, I'm training for something right now.
Really?
Nice.
Yeah.
Is it a triathlon?
It is.
I read them like a book.
A baby one.
You can't lie to me, Dexter. When you say you're training for a triathlon, I know you're talking about training for a triathlon.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So how's that go? What's the goal there?
Just to finish it and see if I like it.
A full size?
No, it's a small one. It's like you could probably complete it in like an hour and a half.
Is it because a full one is nuts.
Pretty badass.
A full one is 2-point-something miles swimming. For some bizarre reasons, like 109 miles cycling or something. It's not 100.
Right.
They should just fucking
like
stop
a marathon.
At 100. And then you have to run a marathon at the end.
Oof.
Yeah, that's a little nuts.
That'd be a lot.
Yeah. Although... I would argue now, what is a small triathlon?
Well, the one I'm doing, it's going to be in Long Beach, and it's just a 500-yard swim. So what is that, like a not quite a half a mile?
Mm-hmm.
And then an 8-mile bike ride and a 4-mile run.
8 mile before you could fucking do that drunk tomorrow. What do you have to, don't train for that. You know how you guys are like practicing before you go on tour?
Yeah, right.
You know what I would like? I would love to see a... Because this has to happen. I mean, it happens in music. It probably happens on stage. It happens in comedy for sure. I would like to see the first night out for a band versus the end of the tour and just how much tighter and better. Because there really is no practice like playing shows night after night.
That's true. Yeah. You get better.
That's why I've always hated like just doing, you know, on a fraction of a scale, like musicals and stuff. Everybody comes to opening night. I go, please don't go to opening night.
Right.
Do you feel that way? Or you're past that.
Yeah, the people of Fresno can fuck themselves.
That's right.
And who's going to travel to Fresno?
That's true. No.
Let's don't put the barbecue at the beginning of our touring season. Right.
Right.
Wanna
right.
Be tight.
We have some of you conducting the marching band that Brian brought up.
How many times have you done USC? At the USC halftime, done the marching band? Because I feel like I've been there. I have season tickets for well over a decade and a half. I feel like I've been there for multiple occasions.
I think twice.
So
was it?
Multiple, technically.
Something like that. I mean, I went to USC, and I was just kind of on my couch one day watching Saturday football or whatever, and all of a sudden they're cutting to commercial and the band's playing my song, and I had no idea. And so I kind of reached out and said, hey, that's cool that you're playing. I went there, and they thought it was like someone hassling them or whatever. Yeah. Like, this isn't really the guy from The Offspring. Is this somebody from UCLA? Are you going to sue us or whatever? But I eventually went to meet them, and they were great, and we've been friends ever since.
That's so cool. And they do neocon too sometimes. Like, they do a couple of your songs.
They put a bunch into their set over the years.
It's very cool. I'm a big fan, obviously.
Oh, right on. Yeah. Thank you.
Of the USC and the band, and when they play your music, I'm a fan of your band. So it's a perfect sort of synergy. Like, oh, this is awesome.
Yeah, their director just retired. He was there for literally 50 years. The
Legend.
Guy was there. And
Art Partner.
Yeah. So they had a little celebration. I went in there and they got to see the whole band in their rehearsal. And that's being so in a cool. small room with them was really cool.
Did you already know how to conduct? I mean, people think it's like 1, 2. No, it's difficult. People have to watch the conductor.
Yeah. No, I have no idea what I'm doing.
You just did a lot of pointing.
Did I?
I don't know.
You point, give me more. There. Yeah.
Well, let's see.
Yeah, we have a clip.
Ooh. No, I don't think we do.
Never mind.
I thought you found the clip. Sorry. I will say this, if you have a job where someone sets up an A-frame ladder and you climb up it, it's either a horrible job, you're either at Home Depot or you're trimming shrubs, or it's a killer job, you're conducting the USC marching
band. Yes. Yeah.
Right. If someone sets up an A-frame ladder outside, it's either good or bad in terms of career. All right, let me tell you about Hyundai Tucson. Hyundai questioned everything to create the best Tucson ever. Every inch of the all-new Tucson has been completely reimagined, resulting in an SUV loaded with innovations inside and out. From design to technology to safety, every aspect of the new Tucson has been improved and completely redesigned. Digital key allows you to use your phone, by the way, as a spare key. Talk about technology. They also have a big touchscreen on its 10.25 inches, which is very large inside a car like this. And its full-touch infotainment screen system, LED daytime running lights stylishly hidden in the front grille. It's really a good SUV, and it's really a good price point, and it has tons of technology. So check it out. Hyundai Tucson. You can learn more at Hyundai.com. Speaking of Hyundai, we did a Save Our Stages bit for Hyundai a few weeks back, and they're talking about talking to different bands and different performers and talking about stages they've been on and like memories of big nights. Like we were talking before you got here about being at the Shrine for the Acoustic Christmas and how hard you guys rocked that night and how the balcony was just bouncing up and down. You have a stage, you have a favorite place, you have a memory of, I don't know, something funny, something interesting, when it dawned on you, you guys had hit it big.
Yeah, I mean, so many different things, but I think the first Weenie Roast was like that, where, because that stage, it rotates, and then they open up the curtains, and there you are.
Irvine Meadows,
yeah. During the day, we weren't first, but we were kind of in the middle, and all of a sudden it opens up, and bam, and the first couple songs were okay, but when we got to like the single Come Out and Play, all of a sudden the place just really went off, and it was like, wow.
People singing your lyrics back to you.
Yeah.
Do you remember who you followed?
I think it was James.
Great song.
English band James.
Yeah. Did you know
their song?
Okay.
Had you played any venues that size before that?
No. Yeah.
And I've been on stage there a million times at the Weenie Roast. It's just a wall of people. It looks like it's kind of like a tidal wave of people when you're standing on stage. It just goes all the way up. It just keeps going up, maybe 14,000 people.
James had a great hit. That's undeniable.
Oh, yeah, this song. Yeah, I like this song. The Violent Femmes. Oingo Boingo. Oh, the Pretenders. Yeah, I was there. That was my first Weenie Roast.
Yeah.
Because I got to
Dexter's
K-
too?
I got to K-Rock. Yeah.
Right around that time.
Yeah, I got to K-Rock about April, May, and this was June, and I remember it was a big deal. You get to go to your first, you know, yeah, concert. I hadn't been to concert because I was just too poor before that, and I remember,
quite a lineup.
Pavement, James, Frente, Candlebox, the Afghan Whigs, Beck, Rollins Band, Green Day. Oh, that was kind of Green Day's big kind of coming out party too. They
Counting
were
Crows.
they were really good. Counting Crows, Pretenders.
Damn, that's top heavy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it was good. It was fun.
Who you remember? So James was in front of you. Do you remember who was after you?
No.
Yeah.
Who cares?
Yeah, I was off in another world by then.
How many, so that was like a big moment, right?
Oh, yeah, that was
and
huge.
Especially your local, right? Like, yeah, this is K-Rock.
For sure. I think it's more intimidating when you're playing your hometown. I don't know. Something about if you're in, you know, Germany, it doesn't matter as
Fresno
much.
Fresno or
doesn't
wherever.
Feel the same, but
fucking Fresno.
You know, yeah, I can look at that crowd and I can pick out my mom instantly, right? So you've always got that.
Yeah, the... So that was the Offspring. So the off, when did you guys hit on K-Rock?
It was 94.
Right. Do you remember what month?
It was April.
So we both got to K-Rock at the exact same time?
Yeah. I didn't cross paths with you right away, I don't think. But
obviously you guys were getting played and I was like phoning in and showing up and trying to get a job. But we both were there in April of 94.
You're April also?
I'm April of 94 because, well, we'd have to figure out when the Bleeda and Reseda was, when the boxing match was. But I'm pretty, the reason I'll always know that date is because I was going to turn 30 in May of 94. And I always said, I got to be doing something by the time I'm 30. And I knew I was turning 30. And it was right before my 30th birthday. So it was like mid-April, end of April, whatever.
What's funny about that is I was a high school student in April of 94 listening to Live 105 in the Bay Area. And that's when Come Out and Play hit, you know, like an atomic bomb on the radio. And I remember, I don't know if you remember this, Dexter, or even aware of this. They made a thing. Dawson, do you remember this? They made a thing like, we're playing this song every hour on the hour. And they did. Like you could set your watch to it. They're playing that in heavy rotation.
Yeah, it really took off. I mean, I remember I had just received an invitation to our 10-year high school reunion, right? And I'm like, oh, man, because the song hadn't hit yet, right? And I'm like, oh, man, I'm a loser. I've been out of college 10 years. Everyone, 10 years, if you're a lawyer or a doctor, you've gone through the grad school and all that stuff. And I thought, I'm going to be the lamest guy. At the
thing. Hey, Dr. Holland.
Luckily, it hit in April. And, you know, August, I was looking good at the reunion. Right?
So I didn't quite share that story because, remember, I was 30, so I'm 2 years older. Yeah. So if you go back 2 years, I had, taking like, digits, roommates and swinging a hammer and pulled up in a Zuzu Trooper. None of the shit had worked out on my 10-year high school reunion. I just missed it. But I came back with a vengeance on the 20-year.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's the ring.
All the ass.
Yeah. So I had some making up to do. All right. We'll take a break. Dexter will hang out. We'll come back and do some news right after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral. Weird crime, protest, politics. Give me news with Gina Grad. Stuff-Face on TMZ. Joe Biden, Kamala. Meet news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
I would normally consider this a top story, but for this crowd, I think it's appropriate. Simple Flying reports that United Airlines has announced it will be the first U.S. airline to operate supersonic passenger aircrafts from Boom Supersonic. The airline will take 15 Boom Overture aircraft with an option of 35 more, hopefully in service by 2029. The most likely routes would be transatlantic, transpacific, so like Newark to London, 3.5 hours.
Boom.
San Francisco to Tokyo, 6 hours. The Boom Overture will be a 65 to 88 seat premium aircraft capable of reaching Mach 1.7. And the Overture is the first aircraft planned to be net zero carbon from launch.
Mach 1.7 is Boom. Over 1,000 miles an hour, I think.
Depending on...
To get to Tokyo in 6 hours,
nah,
probably.
This one doesn't depend. Like, if you can get from Mach 1.7, over 1,000.
What I meant, Dexter would know much more about this than I would. Mach, where you are, it depends on how high you are and the atmosphere. And
exactly. It's not a static number.
But it's probably...
But at that level, it would be...
At 1.7, you're always going to be over, over
1,100 miles an hour.
That's kicking ass. I wonder what this thing looks like.
There are pictures. We have them. So look at that. I mean, it looks like a bullet. I don't know how to describe that.
It looks like one of those needlefish.
Yeah.
If anyone knows what a needle, you probably speared a few of those things. You know what a needle, it looks like the Concorde, basically, in many ways, because it's just not. You got to be super long, you got to be super thin, and you have to have a real swept wing and not a lot of drag, and that's how they roll.
Well, and speaking of the Concorde, let me just give you an idea of what makes it a net zero carbon situation. So it uses a combination of materials like carbon composites, titanium, aluminum. It can reach supersonic speeds without the use of afterburners. That, of course, was used by the Concorde. It's also planned to operate fully and with sustainable aviation fuel. I don't know if that's peanut oil or what.
Yeah, I don't know that anyone who has, $26,000 for a one-way flight to Tokyo gives a fuck about sustainable this or that. They've probably done enough harm to the environment, but it's a good selling point.
It is. And I think there's a picture of the inside, at least what they're, a prototype. It looks pretty cool. It looks like a very fancy train.
Yeah, it's narrow, but it's sleek and it's cool. And the tickets are going to be super expensive, right?
Of course. But it reminds me of, when we first invented cars and people were afraid over, 35 miles an hour, their faces would melt off. Do we know enough about, we already go Mach 1.7 in things, yes? We know our faces don't melt
spacecraft.
Off. Spacecraft. Well,
and there's probably...
But I mean more...
It's not
pedestrian.
Really. There's not much military stuff that does that kind of speed these days. I don't think. Dexter might know.
There have been, right?
There have been. We gave up. So in what happened with the military, I think, is sort of like what happened with commercial stuff. So it used to be all about speed. Mm-hmm. And we'd get in the Blackbird, the SR-71 and stuff like that. It could fly Mach 2.0, whatever, it's classified or something. But we didn't have satellites. So now we have satellites.
Right.
So we spy on, the Blackbird, which is the killer looking aircraft, military aircraft, doesn't have any guns on it. It was just there to take pictures.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I don't think people know that. It looks like it's firing rockets and Gatling guns and shit like that.
Yeah.
It doesn't. It would just fly so fast that the Soviets couldn't intercept it with their ground-to-air rockets, and then would take pictures.
Oh, that's cool.
But we don't need to take pictures anymore because satellites take pictures of everything. So we don't need the super-fast military stuff anymore. We have more shit like the A-10 Warthog and stuff like that. Not swept wing, meant to fly slow with a huge cannon on the front of it to destroy tanks and things like that.
That's
so I don't think we're going as much about speed as we are just about
stealth.
Stealth and technology, missiles and guided stuff and all that. Have you guys, Max Powell, you might be able to find this, but what the A-10 Warthog has in front of it is basically a Gatling gun, and it just shoots depleted uranium shells, like just the hardest substance known to man. But have you seen the Iron Dome shit working? The Iron Dome shit is a phalanx gun. The phalanx gun, as long as we're taking a military dive here, but the phalanx gun is a Gatling gun, and it's like radar controlled. And so if you're flying in an aircraft carrier, you're cruising in an aircraft carrier and someone launches a bunch of missiles at you and they're just skimming above the ocean and they're going to impact you, the phalanx gun just it just sprays rounds as fast and destroys it.
Damn.
Before it gets to you. And if you see, there is some Iron Dome shit out there that's crazy. So you see all of these rockets being fired into Israel and these phalanx guns that are all on computer guided, you know, radar guide. And then you see them moving around and then like locking on a missile. And then they just go. And you see all this. It's not tracer stuff. It's like red hot coming out of the thing. And then they just blow the missile up. They just shoot it down. But they're not shooting it with a missile. They're essentially shooting it with a gun.
Yeah.
And it's a
like
lot.
Like buckshot.
It's a lot like that A-10 Warthog gun. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, we're not going. Military's not really about the speed of the plane
don't
anymore.
Need to.
Is there a military aircraft, Max Pata, that goes 1.7 Mach that is modern? And I don't think there is. But anyway.
Although we have talked before about how some companies are preparing for pedestrian space travel, you know, just to kind of get up to outer space and go, woo, and then come back down. And for some reason, I am not only more interested in that, but have it in my head that that's somehow safer than a sonic jet.
Yeah, but you could get to Honduras in 27 minutes.
That's true.
If you had that. It's probably not going to. That's not going to be one of its routes.
No, I doubt it.
Honduras?
Yeah.
Oh, maybe.
You never know.
You don't know. Yeah. You can't say.
I'll sign up.
That would be a cool plane to be a pilot for.
Oh,
that would be fun.
Sit in front. Mm-hmm. Chris Harrison is out as host of ABC's Bachelor in Paradise, according to Page Six. In February, Chris took a supposedly temporary break from the Bachelor franchise after a little backlash erupted over him defending a contestant who attended the Southern antebellum party. Chris was already sidelined from a season of The Bachelorette. Now, according to Page Six, he's going to be replaced by a revolving cast of guest hosts. That includes David Spade. If you don't remember this controversy, you probably do, but here's a clip from the interview that got him in all this trouble. Chris is answering a question that Rachel Lindsay asked him about Rachel Kirkconnell. She was the one that went to the Southern antebellum party.
A couple of things. First and foremost, I don't know. I haven't talked to Rachel about it. And this is, again, where we all need to have a little grace, a little understanding, a little compassion, because I've seen some stuff online. Again, this judge, jury, executioner thing where people are just tearing this girl's life apart and diving into like her parents and her parents' voting record. And what it's unbelievably alarming to watch this. I haven't heard Rachel speak on this yet. And until I actually hear this woman have a chance to speak, who am I to say any of this? I saw a picture of her
Klansman, man.
5 years ago.
That's a new face of the Klan.
And that's it. Like, boom. This girl is in this book.
Spouting
now.
Out
she's
his
now
racist
in this group.
Rhetoric.
I'm like, really?
I don't want my kids to listen to this guy.
Well,
God,
as,
he's gone.
As you know, he went on, I think, Good Morning America and did a big apology with Michael Strahan. Did not help.
There's a black guy to apologize to. This is how it works. Yeah. The most racist part of society is who's conducting the interviews. Mm-hmm. When we get like the black woman to interview the black woman, and then we got the black guy, but he's not going to interview. You got to apologize.
Paul Roker said no.
There's a MiG, a Max Pat. I don't know why he put a bunch of info and got rid of it on my screen.
It's all right. I didn't want to.
According
you
to
from
Business
the video.
Insider, the fastest fighter jet still being used is the MiG 25 Foxbat. Sustain a cruising speed of Mach 2.8,
which
and
is
overdrive top speed of 3.2.
Fast, but Russian.
Mm.
MiGs are Russian.
The American fastest equivalent is the F-15E Strike Eagle, can fly at a top speed of 3,017 miles an hour.
Oh, that's what the hell year is that from? That's a fast ass.
It's been flying for more than 30 years. I assume they make new versions.
It doesn't look sleek. It doesn't look fast.
You tell
what I mean?
It to the fucking FMV.
It can't go 3,000 miles an hour.
It looks very heavy.
It's Business Insider.
They wouldn't lie.
Seems very dubious to me.
Yeah, I don't know. Twin engine. I have a buddy that flew those.
Whoa.
It'll basically accelerate straight up. It's got a lot of power.
Wow.
F-15s.
Yeah. Interesting. Either way, that thing's 30 years old. I guess my point is we're not making fast stuff anymore. We're making like smart stuff.
That's not the future.
The old stuff was fast. You had a MiG, didn't you, for a while?
It was the plane you flew when you were training to fly a MiG. It's called an L-39, so similar.
So not a MiG?
Not a MIG.
Wasn't there a big thing where people would import MIGs in
here? Yeah, you can buy them.
That's, you know, Russia's kind of the Tijuana of Europe, you know what I mean? Like, if you want something and you got money, you can go get it. You can't get it in San Diego, but hop over the border. You can buy a MIG. I mean, they sell their shit when they're done with it.
Yeah.
And you can get a MIG and then put a more reliable engine in it.
Yeah, you can.
And then go fly them.
But we sell our shit when we're done with it.
Yeah, but we sell it to countries who use it against us later on.
Yeah,
but we're not so stupid to sell it to civilians.
Right, okay. Right.
We'll sell it to other countries that'll have a regime change and then bomb us with it later on. But we don't just sell it to Dexter.
Right. That would be insane.
We wouldn't do that.
I have to ask, Dexter, we're talking about all this stuff. You've done all this stuff. And you seem like Adam, you go on stage, you do all this stuff. You have a low resting pulse. What scares you? Is there anything you're too afraid to try?
I don't know.
Yeah,
there's a lot of
dancing in the stars.
Yeah, right.
Cicadas.
Dancing in the stars. Definitely wouldn't do that. I don't know. I think Everest would be too much, probably.
Probably. Okay, just curious. TMZ reports former Jackass star.
Did you ever, find the Iron Dome stuff? It's pretty. It's pretty insane.
Remember how you said people
standard.
Need to feel what's going on?
Mm-hmm. Well, I was looking for some Iron Dome. Yeah, okay. Somebody. Actually, Pete Brock from BRE and Shelby and all that stuff, he just sent this to me going, this is fucking nuts.
The hell?
It's videos. It's a certain video of the thing just operating, you know, moving around and kind of operating at night. But anyway, go ahead.
Wow. So Bam Margera has been sending increasingly disturbing messages. Oh, look, we're looking at it now.
Yeah, but this is... This Maxipad is of the gun operating, not what it's doing. So you'll see. This got to be out there. This guy sent it to me. Sorry.
Bam has been sending disturbing messages to Jackass director Jeff Tremaine, including threatening his safety and his children. The court has granted.
Doesn't sound like a Jackass guy.
I'll tell you all about it.
Some got hacked.
I'll give you the quote. The court has granted Tremaine's request for a temporary restraining order against Bam. Tremaine claims Margera publicly attacked him, threatened violence, compared him to Harvey Weinstein, posted obscene drawings, and made a comment that he and Johnny Knoxville can, quote, pencil in their death certificate. And on top of that, these texts were going back and forth, and here's one of them.
It's a weird way to publicize this movie.
It is. That's true. I mean, it's getting eyeballs. It says, look at your children and grab your pocketbook and write a check. If you're greedy and cheap, look at your children again. If you don't sign the paper, look at your children. Sign your stupid fucking contract before you're not safe anywhere. According to Jeff, the contract Bam's referring to is one that he just made up himself.
This sounds like substance stuff.
Substance
more than,
or mental, yeah.
Sounds like something's going on.
Bipolar addiction, yes.
Yeah. Didn't someone just die from Jackass?
Yes. Yeah. Shit, I've looked that up.
All right.
But yes.
Yeah, so he's out. But like Brian said, fantastic promotion for any upcoming Jackass-related stuff. We love to talk about bidding and auctions and stuff on this show, and I think we have a new front runner, an invisible sculpture by Italian art, and I have no picture to show you, by Italian artist Salvatore Garo, sold for $18,000 at auction. While the invisible work titled I Am may seem like nothing, Garo says the invisible piece is a metaphor of our time. He says the void has energy that condenses and transforms into particles, in short, in us. After all, don't we give shape to God we have never seen?
Does this guy cater? You should open a catering business.
Delicious?
It's an empty chafing. You got to use your imagination.
Right.
It's a metaphor for pot roast.
Still hungry. It made a lot of sense to a buyer who, along with the sculpture, bought the certificate of authenticity. And Garo suggests displaying the piece in a 5x5 foot area free from obstructions.
Well, Gina, you're not old enough, but somebody invented something called the pet rock when I was a kid.
70s,
a little too rich for the Corolla's blood.
Sure.
But they invented a pet rock, and they sold 2 billion units of the pet rock.
I have a question about the pet rock. Was it supposed to be a paperweight that they called a pet rock?
No, I think I read about this in the Freakonomics book. I think they did a whole chapter. I read about it in a book. I'm pretty sure it's Freakonomics. And it was like, yeah, this guy just, he was kind of a businessman toiling, and he had this idea that was silly, and it just took off.
But was it a tchotchke? Like, just a tchotchke? It wasn't supposed to do anything.
It was timed with, like, a downturn in the economy when, like, you know, like, you can't afford a nice toy, get this, or you can't afford a pet or something. And it became a thing.
Yeah. So, like, people will ironically purchase things and, you know, having the invisible statue. Do you need to put the stanchions with the velvet rope around it?
I would.
Someone walks into it and kills themselves.
It's all pompous circumstances.
I was just going to say that. You have to. Otherwise, you're just an asshole.
What did it go for?
$18,000.
Phalanx, Iron Dome. Anything, Max Spada?
I haven't found anything on the internet, but I just had Matt forward me Pete's email. So
That's interesting. All right. Well, we can... I was curious. I still don't know
Pete
how the
sent
internet
it as
works.
An attachment, not a link. So he somehow just had this on his computer. I don't know.
But it's always weird, like how the internet works, which is somebody videoed it and put it somewhere. But anyway, this is Pete Brock's legendary car designer. Blah blah blah. Made the Corvette split window 63 work for Shelby. Made the Shelby Daytona. Like, he's a super interesting dude. Still around. Still living in Nevada. All right, I'll try to find that in a second. First, I'll tell you about LifeLock. An Arizona family was surprised with a change of address notification they didn't request. It was an attempt to steal their mail and access personal information to steal their identities. It's important to understand how cybercrime and identity theft are affecting our lives every day. We put our info at risk on the internet. In an instant, cyber criminals could harm your finances and your credit. Good thing there's LifeLock. LifeLock helps detect a wide range of identity threats, like your social security number, for sale on the dark web. If they detect your information has potentially been compromised, they'll send you an alert and you'll have access to a dedicated restoration specialist. It's LifeLock, right, Dawson?
No one can prevent all identity theft or monitor all transactions at all businesses, but you can keep what's yours yours with LifeLock by Norton. Join now and save up to 25% off your first year by using promo code Adam. Call 1-800-LIFELOCK or head to LifeLock.com and use promo code Adam for 25% off.
So here, Gina, you're gonna get moist here because this is the thing protecting your people.
Oh, that's right. Damn, so it's called Star Wars.
It's called the Phalanx system.
Phalanx.
It's part of the Iron Dome. They're shooting at a target being towed by a Learjet.
Damn! How far does it go?
I don't know what the...
The target's three feet long, doing 500 miles per hour or so.
This is futuristic shit. Wow.
Ooh, got another one.
Yeah, the system tracks every round by radar and adjusts the aim like a garden hose.
That's insane.
Yeah, so you wonder, how do you shoot down all these missiles? At a certain point, the missiles will just start raining in, and these things will start... It's not all being towed by a Learjet, although that's a... That's a tough draw as a pilot, Dexter, right? Like, I want you to tow a drone. Now, some of these things aren't totally calibrated, so keep your eyes open.
Scary.
They could always mistake you for a missile, but here we go.
Yes.
Jeez, you got like 12 feet of lamp cord here, shouldn't we? Yeah, we'll keep it close to the plane. Towing a drone.
Oh,
sorry,
my
you
God.
Can... You can scrub forward a little bit, Max Zapata, and you'll see that these, at a certain point, they just start launching all of these rockets. Damn. You can play it. Go ahead. Put the sound effect. They just start launching rockets everywhere, and these things just start spraying it with these little Gatling guns that are basically shooting spent uranium shells. But not explosive, I don't think. They just...
What do you mean?
The shell, I mean, the missile's exploding, but it's just being hit with a bullet, essentially.
Wow. That's crazy.
And they just set them up out, like, in the desert, the perimeter, whatever. They just...
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah. It's crazy. It's crazy footage.
This is nightmare fuel.
Yeah. All right. But anyway, thank God. No, so it's really, it's like Israel's got the technology. And Palestine's got a bunch of Chinese and Russian shit that they're just going to launch the kitchen sink at them. But their missiles are like, I don't know, 800 or 1,000 bucks a piece or something. Like, there's no money in that. They'll just launch it and try to see if they can get a percent through. But the Phalanx system is fucking intense.
That's insane.
Well, Americans are even more insane because we're like, well, what if we put one of those on a C-130? What if we just put one on an open door of a C-130 gunship, like wings, propellers, I think it's a prop plane, or A-10 Warthog? If you see the C-130 gunship with the phalanx on it, they just go like a super slow circle. You know what's always crazy to me? If one of those planes in a crew ever just went rogue and just wanted to fly around the United States, you know, fly into New York or Los Angeles or something, they just kill 200,000 people in an afternoon, like easy. Like, they would scramble fighter jets and stuff, but if someone just went nuts on one of those, just grab one of those planes and
cowboy.
Said, I'm just going full cowboy here, I'm a super disgruntled employee, like the guy they asked to fly the Learjet with the drone. That guy went, fuck it.
That's it.
I'm getting in the C-130. It's payback time. It's never really happened.
Carnage. Yeah,
it's
thank
never
God.
Happened with all the military, with all the stuff we have. But there's got to be a plan for it.
You imagine.
I mean,
so.
There's got to be scrambling jets. But scrambling jets, you got a good... You're going to get a half hour of flying time with that gunship.
This is where my caveman brain comes in, because though I know this probably doesn't have an impact on it, I want to be like, stop talking about it.
That's
stop
right.
Stop speaking it into existence.
You're right
about the I'm going to fuck this up completely, but there was always legend and semi-verified. There's a building in El Segundo, a tall one here in LA, where supposedly a jet or two can take off from for some sort of, you know, airport attack or something like that. I think they have them in a lot of major cities. They don't obviously publicize.
I don't think you could launch it. Jet
with vertical takeoff technology, they could probably do it, right?
That sounds weird to me.
But I don't know.
JPL's down there, or Northrop? Something big's down there.
Northrop Grumman.
Yeah,
I don't know. That sounds. Vertical. Yeah, you wouldn't need to be on the roof or whatever. Like with that.
I've heard legend from people who would know.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah, with vertical, but. It's still, you're going to get a while in that gunship. Although, God knows where the gunship, you can find that, Max Zapata. God knows where the gunship is coming from. They'd probably track you long before you got over Encino in that thing. But the C-130 gunship just going full Gatling gun is crazy.
That's insane.
Yeah.
So I have some hot audio for you. Literally, a radio reporter from Denmark went all the way to scoop on a swingers club near Copenhagen. So she did her due diligence and had sex with this dude while she was interviewing him.
Dedication.
According to the New York Post, 26-year-old Louise Fisher.
She's going for that Pulitzer.
Yeah, can be heard moaning during the on-the-record intercourse, part of a 2-minute segment that aired on Radio 4 in Denmark. The segment focused on the reopening of the swingers club named Swingland after lifting COVID-19 restrictions. There she is. She says many listeners, including her parents, thought it was funny and brave and cool. This is some audio from the actual...
Including her parents. I guarantee her dad
he thought it was hilarious.
He didn't want an air check of that particular encounter.
This is a snippet of audio, feel free to call your own out, that aired on the radio in Danish.
Jeg vil gerne lige fortælle, hvad du ser lige nu.
Interviewing him.
State your name for the record.
I think that quote was, she asked him like, what are you seeing right now, or what are you doing right now? And he said in Danish, like, I'm looking at a delicious woman. And that was, like, please don't.
You got to sign this release. Oh, I got a full release coming, baby. Stand back.
A little audio fun for you.
All right, Max Pattis, C-130 gunship, Gatling gun. May not be a C-130.
Give her the phalanx.
I'm still scrubbing through these videos. These videos are long, and a lot of them are from inside, and I'm trying to find...
I'll do inside. How crazy is that Iron Dome system?
I can't believe it's real.
And how weirdly futuristic, robotic, killer, whatever shit is that.
But also incredibly old school, the phalanx. I mean, that's what the fucking Spartans used.
Yeah. Oh, it is.
You know what a phalanx is?
No, I only knew about the phalanx system.
Like if you've seen 300, it's when they all get their shields and they form an iron dome and they all get the shields.
That's the phalanx.
When the arrows come up and down.
They form a phalanx.
Wow. Did not.
That's where the word comes from.
Did not know it. All right, so we'll just play this for a second. Just a crew on a slow flight, and they just. It's probably not a phalanx system, and they just do this big, low circle. And if you're underneath this fucking plane, you are fucking dead no matter what you're in.
Look at that.
It's all very RoboCop-y, isn't it? Now, this is one where they're firing missiles at this point.
What if you just
fly
your family to Honduras?
Yeah, look out.
Jesus.
The weight of each of those.
Those are big. I don't know. Don't they have one that's a phalanx system, or they have one that shoots smaller? Doesn't matter. Either way.
This is their most popular video. So it's like 26 million views, and this is firing all of its cannons, but it's 15 minutes long.
So all right. Well, that's fine. Anyway, it's crazy.
Only 15?
We should rule the world with this kind of technology. We're too nice. You know what I mean? Mm. We're always talking about, Russia, China, Canada.
We
sometimes.
Got stuff.
Yeah, we should go get some. All right, bring it home, Gina Grad.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news. I'm looking at a delicious woman.
Gina Grad!
That was the news with Gina Grad.
What percentage of things were they announced? Oh, what does your dad think about you being in, Felch Weekly? Oh, he loves it. He loves it.
He thinks it's so proud.
He's proud.
And he showed the guys at work. He did? Or they showed him? Because I guarantee there are guys at work discussing this, but I think you're going the wrong direction on this.
Didn't bring it up.
Here it is. Sorry.
My God.
It's just firing. Just fucking crazy.
It looks like it's a fireworks display.
Yeah. It's crazy. All right. Hyundai. Yeah, Hyundai Tucson. 15 seconds for Hyundai Tucson. New Tucson. It's an SUV that's loaded with innovation inside and out. You can learn more at Hyundai.com. Dexter, when are we going out for tacos, man?
Let's do it.
I guess it says Dexter doesn't need a little arm twist and you go out for tacos.
Yeah. We exchange messages sometimes saying, hey, let's get a taco. And we say,
I mean it.
Okay.
COVID's over.
Okay.
Let's celebrate with some tacos.
Would love to.
I won't be happy until I see a picture of after dinner with Adam, Dexter, and John Popper.
Oh, man.
That's the holy trinity.
Yeah. Going out with John. He disappointed me. He ordered mushroom soup.
It's not rock and roll.
Yeah.
That is not.
That's great aunt material.
Enjoy your mushroom soup, Todd. Whatever your name is, John, rock and roll. What kind of name is that, man? Tagar? Wait a minute. What's Todd's nickname?
Gitad.
Gitad. Shit, I fucked it up. So stupid, Adam. What are you doing?
Bear yourself for a text.
Yeah, let's go out for a taco. I'll come to your neck of the woods.
Awesome.
And we'll do it in Honduras.
Okay.
You guys are all invited.
The next
I'll
trip.
Buy, you fly. Woo! I'm on fire today. Todd can stay in and tell me he needs some more band practice. The rest of you guys are good.
Yeah.
The album, by the way, Let the Bad Times Roll, another great album from The Offspring. And it's available wherever you listen to music. And shoot them a tweet and Instagram at Offspring as well. And Vinny Tortorich. And you can go to AdamCarolla.com for all the live shows. I'm coming all over the country to see you. And until next time, this is Adam for Dexter and Vinny and Gina and Vault saying mahalo. I don't want to be perceived as hetero.